weeks. That beats anything I ever seen. All right, we sure are glad that you're here today, and we're going to rejoice and praise the Lord together. Make sure you read through your bulletin and take advantage of all those things. Brittany, you still need people to sign up for trunk or treat or candy?
So the trunk or treat is going to be on Saturday, October 30th.
I bought 3 bags of candy, but I was on vacations. I'm just kidding. I just bought 4. All right, make sure you read through your bulletin and do all those types of things. The Mary Small Circle meets tomorrow night in Judy Bowman Sunday School class, so ladies, don't forget that if you would, please. Next Sunday's homecoming. It's going to be a little strange, so... I see at least 6 different kinds of banana pudding sitting here, so it'll be all right. So bring your food, and let's eat together. Brother Paul Pure will be preaching next Sunday morning for our homecoming message. So I hope you'll be here and be part of that. All righty. Continue to pray for Donna and her family and the passing of her mom. They have a thank you note here. It says, during our time of sorrow, we learn how much our friends mean to us. Your kindness, sympathy will always be remembered by the family of Catherine Clure. So we appreciate that. And then Ronnie's dad had some stents put in this week. He's still doing well. He probably chopped wood or something yesterday. I don't... Yeah. All right. So praise the Lord for that. it's been years ago we prayed for a lady's husband. Her name was Kim Robertson. He had some neck issues and all kinds of stuff, if you remember. She's having... some tests on tomorrow. She's got some, sounds like major issues, but you never know till the tests are over with. So be praying for Kim Robbins. And then our former church secretary, Lim Bumgarner, passed away, and the service is today at the graveside. The information's in your bulletin just for you to read and take advantage of that if you want to. All righty, any other announcements?
We will resume choir practice this afternoon at regular time.
All right, so all the choir. All righty, so be in your place if you can. All righty, anybody else or anything else? All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer and thank Him for His many, many blessings. Our Father, it is with grateful hearts that we enter into your presence today. God, you have been gracious and kind in so many ways and by so many people. God, you continue to show yourself faithful, and we rejoice and give thanks for that. God, it is in your strength and power that we go each day. And I pray, God, that that strength will be sufficient for the things of today. God, we do pray for those that are grieving, those that are sick, those that are recovering from procedures and surgeries and those types of things. We just pray for a speedy recovery, a quick recovery, and a complete recovery for your honor and for your glory. Now just be with us as we enter in this time of worship and praise today. May our worship and our praise come out of an abundance of the heart. For God, you are worthy of all worship and praise. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, he is our all in all. And let's stand together and sing this song, "You Are My All in All."
Worthy is your name.
and all. Lord, you're the only one that we can trust in. You're the only one we can be confident in. Lord God, we love you. We thank you. And I pray, Father, that you guide and direct us through this service today. May your Holy Spirit guard us and watch over us. Lord, we will trust in you for all things. Lord, we just ask during this time, you give us your Holy Spirit, you give us Jesus, and take us through this service today. May we have open hearts and minds to receive what you have for us this day. Let's sing this song, Give Me Jesus. This is our prayer today. Give me Jesus.
In the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus.
Mark 8:36 says, for what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? This next song he keeps me singing says, he feels my longing. He keeps me singing as I go. Let's sing this song, Jesus, the sweetest name. He keeps me singing.
There's within my heart a melody. Jesus whispers sweet and low. Fear not, I am with thee, peace be still. In all of life ebb and flow. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. My life with pain. Jesus wept across the broken strings, stirred the slumbering chords again. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Sometimes he leads through waters deep, trials fall across the way. Though sometimes the path seems rough and steep, see his footprints all the way. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. back to welcome me far beyond the starry sky. I shall wing my flight to worlds unknown. I shall reign with him on high. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know.
Let's have a prayer for our offering this morning. Father God, we do thank you, Lord, again for the opportunity to gather in your house. We thank you for the presence of your Holy Spirit here among us this day. And Lord, I do. I pray again that all hearts and minds will be open to receive this message today. Lord, may we leave here changed today from what you reveal to us. And now, Lord, as we're given an opportunity to give back just a portion of your many blessings, I pray for this offering today that it might be used beyond these walls, Lord, throughout our neighborhoods and even beyond, to let others know the love of Jesus Christ. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'm from the country, and I learn slow. On vacation, my wife said, you need some retail therapy. So I went. I didn't know what she was telling me. So if you need a shoebox, see Miss Parker. That's all I'm saying about it. We did have a great time on our vacation, and appreciate y'all praying for us over the last several weeks. You can tell the voice is not quite back yet. And breathing is not back yet. I get winded pretty easily right now. So we'll go as long as we can today, or 12 o'clock, whichever comes first. Amen. If you turn to Joshua chapter number 1, Joshua chapter number 1. This message is 3 weeks behind schedule. It's the one I was supposed to preach the Sunday that we had the COVID, or the first Sunday we missed with COVID. So God's sovereign over these things. We're going to assume that you're the crowd that needs to hear it since you're here today. Changes are getting ready to take place for the nation of Israel. We'll make mention of some of the things that's happened earlier a little bit later on. But they've sent the spies out, and they come back with the report. 10 said you can't do it. 2 said you can. And for 40 years, they've wandered in the wilderness. And at the close of those 40 years of wandering, God tells Moses, Moses, you don't get to go in the promised land. Because of your sin, I'm going to let you see it. He took him up on the mountain. He could see with supernatural vision all the land and the things that were there. And Moses dies. And Joshua is chosen to be his replacement. And God's now giving him instructions about going over into the promised land. Now remember, Joshua was one of the two that gave the good report. He's already been there. He's walked every hill, every valley, crossed the streams. All the things that was there, he has seen. So he knows what's in store for the rest of the nation. But God, in the first chapter of Joshua, says, be encouraged, Joshua. Now, they still remember the evil report. There's giants in the land. It's too strong for us to take. Joshua, have courage. I'm going to be with you. I'm not going to leave you. I'm not going to forsake you. I'm going to give you this land. So God is in preparing him to prepare the people to go over to the promised land. Moses led the people for all those years and then through the 40 years in the wilderness. God gave him the law. And they've been under law for all these years, doing and sacrificing and all the things that God had said. Now Joshua comes on the scene and he symbolizes grace. A change is getting ready to take place. And this is where the picture of the New Testament, the church and all the things begin to show up in the Old Testament as far as this story is related. In the New Testament, it tells us the law came by Moses. But grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. And Joshua is a picture or a type of Jesus Christ in the Old Testament. Now, well, preacher, what's that got to do anything? When God's grace and truth enters into your life, you're getting ready to start a new chapter. A new chapter of new adventures for new things in your life that you have not yet experienced. And if I could give a title to the message today, it is accepting the new challenges in our life. Now, we all have different makeups as far as our personalities and those types of things. Back in the younger days, as a young buck, if you put a goal in front of me, I was going to meet the goal, hair lip the devil. It didn't make no difference. If you said it couldn't be done, I was going to try to show you it can be done. That's just who I was. Now you say it can't be done, so I go get on the couch and rest. Well, preacher, when is that new challenge? It can begin today. It should have begun the day by faith you received Jesus Christ as your Savior. All that God had promised was there for your taking. But many Christians spend most of their life wandering around in the wilderness, knowing what God has provided, knowing the bunch of grapes it took two men to carry out of the land. They knew all the blessings and all the things that was across the river. But a generation died off because they had not faith enough to cross the river. Now another generation is coming along and they're going to have the opportunity to go over and claim all the promises, all the blessings, all the things that God had told them was going to be theirs. They now have the opportunity to do that. So today as we tell this story, I'm going to liken it to your story and to my story. The first step in accepting the new challenges of life is to accept the commission. Joshua, take the people and cross the Jordan River into the land of promise. That's Joshua's job description. He is to be a leader of a nation, his nation, a people that have been around him for 40 plus years. They know Joshua. They know all the things about Joshua. They know his life as good as he knows his life. And now God has placed him in a place of leadership that he is to lead the people forward in their journey. It doesn't catch Joshua off guard. It shouldn't take us off guard. It shouldn't take the nation of Israel off guard, because God had already promised that Joshua would be the leader. But even a leader appointed or chosen by God, it's still hard for people to follow. Because this new commission, this new journey is frightening. They're going to have to do battle against giants, against walled cities, against all the things that God says is going to have to happen. They're going to have to do that. And listen, new things are scary. New things are scary. But God has given us a commission, just like he gave Joshua a commission, to take the people and lead them into the promised land. In Matthew, he gave the church a great commission. Go ye into all the world. Have you heard that before? Go ye into all the world, making or teaching disciples as you go. Now listen, when we by faith received Jesus Christ as our Savior, that became our commission. Well, preacher, we're not missionaries. I'm not talking about being a missionary. Preacher, we're not preachers. I'm not talking about being a preacher. I'm talking about following God's command to go forward in life. Oh, but preacher, it's scary. You see the story? Preacher, you don't know what lies out there. I've heard there's giants out there. Now, we named them different. We named them by sin. And I'm not going to list sins. It's not about the sin. It's about going out and confronting the enemy of God. Confronting the enemy of God with God's instructions and guidance. Now, listen. Today, we're going to have a choice to make. Now, you may have been saved a year, or 5 years, or 20 years, or 50 years, and never followed God. But today, we're going to be reminded of that commission to follow God into the enemy territory and claim victory in his name. Have you ever heard any of that stuff before? It's nothing new. But it's whether you and I will take the challenge to go forward or not. In verses 3 and 4 of chapter 1, I want you to listen. Now, this is God's word to Joshua. Every place that the sole of your foot hits, what is the promise? It will be given unto thee. Now listen, what did God just say? Joshua, unless you accept my instructions, unless you accept my commission and cross this river, you will never be able to enjoy all that I have in store for you. But Joshua, if you will pick up and pack up and move everywhere that your feet is seated or steps, you will be able to declare victory. The reason most of us as Christians never see the victory of God in our life is because our feet are not going where God told us to go. Amen, preacher. We haven't accepted the commission. It's not too late. As long as there's breath in our body, we can say, God, I will follow you to the ends of the earth that you might receive the honor and glory and give the victory in your name. Joshua's always been there. He spied out the land. He knows all the choice places. Do you not think Joshua is going to lead them to the best places he saw when he was in the land before? He knows where he's headed. Now, there is a big city called Jericho that they got to get by as they cross the river, but we know the story. There's no big deal there. God gives the victory. Well, preacher, what's it got to do with anything? Now, I want you to listen. Just as I told you, Joshua's already been there. He's already experienced the new land. And dear friends, the place that we're trying to get people to go to is a place that we've already experienced. When we by faith trusted in Jesus Christ as our Savior and began to walk the journey, all I have to do now is tell people about my journey. That's all it is. I can tell them about the God who met the needs. I can tell them about the God who strengthens. I can tell them about, but it's about my story. My experiences. Hey, folks, don't be afraid. I saw the grapes. I saw the rivers. I saw the mountains. I saw everything, and it is good. Let's go. And dear friend, that's what your journey is about. It's about trying to lead people to the same thing that you've already experienced in your life. Your report and my report is always good. God is always good. And what God does is always good. You say, but preacher, it's good. It may not look good. It may not sound good. But it is good. And dear friends, as we take our challenge and go on our journey, we are telling a story that we're familiar with. And we know that the story has a good ending in it. Why would anybody not want to join us in the journey? We've stopped telling the story of how good God is and how great His provision is. And as a church, not just Baton Baptist Church, but the church, we have started focusing on the sin of people instead of the people. Now, I want you to listen. Now, I've been 30 years. You know my stance on sin. But listen. We're living in a time that's different from any other time. We're facing generations, especially this newest generation, we're facing a generation like we have never faced before. And it is a daunting task. It is a terrifying task because we don't talk the language they talk, do we? Because I can't type that fast. Well, Miss Parker, she said in some conference yesterday, and they might even be younger than Cameron. They're young whippersnappers. They say in 8 seconds they can send, 8 seconds they can send so many texts, so many Facebook things. I can't even get my phone out in 8 seconds. But they never stop. Never. 24/7, it's all about Snapchat, FaceChat, whatever them other chat. I don't know all this. But see, that generation knows. But we did learn one thing. You can tell that generation you shouldn't be a homosexual and they're going to look at you like you're. The problem is we have to teach them what God says. And when we teach them what God says, then God can change the behavior. Go make disciples as you go. Go teach them. The problem is we're trying to tell them they're a sinner without giving them the help they need to get out of their sin. That's our journey. The same way He saved me, the same way He saved you, is the same way He's going to save a generation. What is this generation? X, Z, Y? I've lost count. I can't keep up. Millennial? I don't know. If you're going to reach them, you're going to have to teach them. And you teach them, thus saith the Lord. And the Lord can correct all that other foolishness. But the days of telling me you're a sinner and you need to get saved, they don't listen to that word anymore. Because you're no better than me and I'm no better than you and we're just all in the boat together. So let's just skip and go down the street. That's how they think. Well, preach why challenge. Let's accept the challenge. Let's accept the challenge. And go forward reaching those peoples. In our neighborhoods, in our supermarkets or workplaces, wherever we may find ourselves. But now comes the rub. It is not easy. Because in the first story, they told them about the giants. They told them about the fenced cities. They told them about how impossible it's going to be to conquer that land. So the second thing we have to do in accepting our commission or our challenge is to be willing to handle the conflict. Well, preacher, I don't want to have any conflict. I'm not lining up for it myself. But if you start facing the enemy, guess what you're going to face? You're going to have conflict. The inhabitants are very strong. In their sight, we are as grasshoppers. Remember the story? We're like grasshoppers in their sight. We don't stand a dog's chance. They're going to mop the floor with us. Nothing's changed. Matter of fact, it's been 40 years, and they probably got more weapons and bigger walls and stuff than they had 40 years before. That big old city called Jericho is the first enemy they got to face. Now, I'm not going to rehearse the whole story. Walked around the wall once a day, 7 days, seven times, blowed trumpet. Guess what happened to the walls? They come falling down, and Israel marched straight forward and took the city and won a great victory. Now, I want you to listen. Liken it to our experience as a Christian. If we're willing to accept the challenge of this new life by getting involved in the commission, going forward, doing what God told us to do, you are going to face some enemies. Now, I want you to listen. You've heard about these enemies all your life. They're strongholds. They're not easy to root out. But they got to be removed if you're going to finish your commission. Now, when I say these phrases, you say, well, preacher, you've told us that for 30 years. But unless these giants are rooted out, you can't live in victory in God's promise. Have you ever heard the phrase, we're our own worst enemy? Well, that is the truth in Christianity. Because you and I are the ones we got to do battle with. Not each other, but within us. Now, the Bible's pretty clear. There's three main enemies that we have to face to carry out our commission, to take the gospel message, to teach and train people what it means to be a Christian and believe and act like Christians are to believe and act. God tells us in His Word. And these foes are formidable. The first one is found in 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter number 2, verses 15 through 17. It tells us there that we're going to be in conflict with the world. Well, preacher, you don't have to say any more about that. Well, I wouldn't be a preacher if I didn't say more about that. Amen. Turn to 1 John chapter number 2. First John chapter 2, starting at verse number 15. Love not the world, nor the things of this world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Now, the battleground of our heart is determined by who we love. If we love God and the things of God, then the world's going to be an enemy. But if you love the world and the things of the world's going to be your friend. So as those who are accepting the challenge and starting with the commission and now dealing with the conflict that's coming our way, how well we do with this determines how well we do with the commission. Well, preacher, what does all that mean? Look at verse number 16. Now remember verse 15, love the world or love God. That's your two choices. For all that is in the world is the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. If you underline or mark stuff in your Bible, what does that next phrase say? These are not of the Father. So if the lust of the flesh and lust of the eyes and pride of life, if they are not from God, who are they from? The enemy or the world? I say it's about as plain as you can make it. The problem is, what does that mean? The problem is, this is where you and I have to do battle every day if we're going to be willing to accept the challenge and take care of the commission. We have to battle these battles. These have to be defeated or we'll never finish the job. Now, this can be one of those life-changing messages for all of us if we'll listen. Well, preacher, just tell me what in the world, excuse me, what in the world is the lust of the flesh? The lust of the flesh is simply those desires and longings and wishes that are not from God, but from another source. A little phrase, heart trouble. When your heart is not in love with God, your heart is going to lust after, desire things that are not of God. Miss Parker told me yesterday, riding home, about one of the Kleister seminars she went to. I'm going to call her a counselor. I don't know what she was, but it sounds like what she does. Now listen. She said, I'm shortening the story. She said she couldn't tell you how many people come through her office, preachers included, who would make this statement. I feel God leading me to leave my wife and children and go with this other woman. Now let me ask you a question. Where is his heart? His heart is not in love with God, because God's not going to tell you to leave your family and go hook up with some other woman two states down. Preacher, that don't happen. It happens because people are not fighting the battle. It's within all of us. Just one thought, one click, one whatever you do on the computer, it just takes one. And some word from some little cute girl says, woo! And the heart goes flippity-flop and out the door it goes. Why? Because their heart is not in love with God. And if the heart is not in love with God, it will lust after the things that are not of God. Number two, not only the lust of the flesh, but the lust of the eye. Simply, that means where you find your delights. the treasures and possessions of this world. Now, God calls it covetousness. Wanting and desiring the treasures and things of this world above the treasures of God. Number one, I call it heart trouble. Number two, I call eye trouble. You like what you see too much. You like what you see too much. And when you like what you see too much, guess what you want? What you like. Now listen, preacher, what difference does that make? Listen, if we're going to carry out our commission, if we accept the challenge, we have to win over the world. We have to be in love with God above all else, and we have to keep our eyes in check and keep them on the things of God and the ways of God and the purpose of God and not on the things of this world. Oh, preacher, it doesn't happen that way. What happens, I think it's the first Sunday in February now, I'm not sure. The Super Bowl. The Super Bowl happens on Sunday night. I don't even wonder. People who say, I love God, will choose to stay home and watch the Super Bowl. Oh, preacher. Where do you find your pleasure? Where do you find your pleasure? In what you see. Number three. The world's lust is the flesh, lust of the eye, and the pride of life. And that's ear problems. You love the applause of men. You love to be honored and recognized. And you have ambition to strive for everything that can get you that recognition of men. I put down for that one. Ear problems. You love the praise of man more than the praise of God. Now you may take the challenge and start carrying out the commission. But I promise you these things are going to get in your way. And try to keep you from doing what you know you're supposed to do. And it's a battle. Oh, preacher, not for you. You think too highly of the preacher. Because I have to battle these things every day. These things keep me from doing what I know I'm supposed to be doing, just like they do you. Are we willing to engage in the conflict? For them to enjoy the victories of the promised land, there is going to be battles to be fought. Now remember, who's helping them? God. Who helps us? God. And when we walk in obedience to God, guess what happens? You win. And when you don't walk in obedience to God, you lose. The same thing happens to the nation of Israel when they cross in the promised land. And the same thing's going to happen to us in our life. The challenge before us is to accept that challenge. Well, how many of you had any battles this week with those three things? And I don't mean this hard or mean. But unless you love God with all your heart and living to that degree, you had a battle on your hands this week. Because these things try to get you off track. In the commentary by Redpath, he makes this statement. Speaking to Christians, you are in the wilderness of defeat. Or in the land of victory. See, that's only two choices. Is your life a constant struggle against the powers of darkness and with constant defeat? Or is it a victorious war waged in the power of the risen Lord. You're either winning or losing the battle. Only two choices. Well, preacher, you're not going to make a very good motivational speaker. I'm not, and I'm not trying to motivate. But there is one who is. And in verse number 6, he says, be strong and of good courage. You don't have to be afraid of any enemy that you're going to face once you cross that river. I am your God, and I'm giving you that land. And dear friends, he's saying the same thing to us today. Be strong and of good courage. You're fighting the conflict from victory, not defeat. I'm promising you, as he did in the commission, I will be with you until the end of the ages. And he's going to walk with us every step of the journey. So what is he saying to us in this section? I don't know. I wasn't there, but I think Joshua probably was shaking in his boots because he has now taken and been given a place of leadership and responsibility over a nation. He's been given a position by God himself to go forward and do it. Now, I want you to listen. In this challenge, if you're willing to accept the commission and are willing to fight diligently against the enemies that's going to keep you from carrying it out, I promise you, it doesn't matter how old you are or how young you are, you will be successful because God is doing the work. He just happens to be using you to carry out that responsibility. Oh, it's been a couple months ago now, I guess, and back when Nicole was starting her last part of her journey. I preached a message about the four anchors, you remember? I'm going to use three of those here because this is how you win. This is where you get the courage to put one foot in front of the other, to face the dark things that lay ahead, to go through the struggles that you have to go through in order to win the victory. This is what Joshua has to stand on. This is from where he draws his courage and strength. Joshua, you're not winning the battle in your own strength, but you're going to win because of my power. Now listen, when they cross that river, God's power defeats every... Listen, there is battles. Rocks are thrown and arrows are shot and swords are swapped and all whatever goes on in the battle. But they knew when the battle was over, God's power had prevailed. Let me ask you a question. Of all the gods that was in the promised land, I think it's 7 or 8, I can't remember exactly. Of all the gods that was in the promised land, which of those prevailed against God? Of all those Gentile nations, those heathen nations, who prevailed against God? None. There's a caveat to that, and I'll give it to you in just a minute. Listen, we're going forward in the power of God. We're not going in our own strength. We're not going in our own might. We're going in His power because it's His commission, because He's giving us the challenge. And if we're to go forward, it is in that power that we must go. Joshua, not only will I be your power and strength, Joshua, I will be with you every step of the way. I have the power of God, it is assured. Acts. After that, the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall receive power. Go into all the world, and I will be with you to the end of the ages. We don't have to take a step without knowing God's power, and His presence is with us in the journey. Well, preacher, that's wonderful. But it's all tied to His promises. God promised His power. God promised His presence. God promised the victory. God promised houses that you didn't build. Fields, you're going to reap fields that you didn't sow. You're going to harvest and have cattle and all. I'm giving it to you. In every step. Remember what we started with? Joshua, everywhere you plant your foot, it's going to be yours. So no matter where they went to, in all the promised land, God said, it is yours. But He had to take the first step. You know, how do you eat an elephant? One bite at a time. Well, I don't find out, but it's... Preacher, how do you know this works? By faith, you take one step at a time. With every step, there can be conflict. That which is you was born with inside of you, the lust of the flesh, pride of life, the eyes on, it's there. You're going to have to do battle every day. But when you fight a good fight, when you finish your course, then you can hear, well done, thy good and faithful servant. Amen. Now listen, that's the challenge that's before us. I can promise you, based on this story and what the New Testament teaches us, that God has a lot of good things ahead of us. And because it is so wonderful, many times we stop after we receive Christ as our Savior. But as I've told you all these years, salvation is just the getting in place. Then comes the victories, the blessings, and the promises of God. What great victory is in store for you? I don't have a clue. It may be a wayward son, or a family member, a coworker, or somebody that you meet on the street. I didn't read the whole story. I get stories on my phone all the time about Christian stuff. But the story is about a teenage girl was in trouble, all kinds of trouble, got arrested and thrown in jail. And somehow, she escaped. And as she walked down a highway through, I don't know if it's in a town or some little community, a preacher stopped and gave her a ride. And what a ride it was. For when she got out of that car, she had met Jesus. And He changed her life. Oh, preacher, stuff like that don't happen. Take the challenge. Respond to His commission. Fight, because I promise you, that old preacher said, hey, you don't stop and pick up people. They'll kill you. Have you ever thought that? You never know. I'm not saying you stop and pick up people, but I'm telling you, if the Holy Spirit prompts you, guess what you need to do? And be of courage and good strength. The Lord is with you. And He gives the victory. Just as Israel, so must we move forward in faith. We've got to stand against every enemy, especially those three that we talked about today. And I promise you, He will lead us safely home. Amen. Every eye closed, every head bowed. Today is one of those days. The decisions that you and I make today will have an eternal impact. Whether we choose yes or no, will you, along with me, accept this challenge in life? That from this day forward, we can't do anything about the years that's gone by. Those 40 years that was wasted in the wilderness, they can't change one of those. They can't bring back one person that passed away in those 40 years. They can't do anything. All they can do is go forward. And dear friends, it's within me and all that is within me to urge you to accept the challenge. And the challenge is, follow His commission. Do battle against those enemies that keep you from doing that commission. And go forward in strength and courage. Win in the victories that God provides in the journey. Will you do that? I hope and pray that you do. There may be some here, and you've never by faith trusted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. That's the biggest challenge you have right now. And fear will keep you from making the right decision. Fear of what people would say, remember, lust there. Afraid of what? Don't worry about that. God says, I'll be with you. Step out in faith. By faith today, would you accept what Jesus Christ did at Calvary? On Calvary's cross, He offered a perfect sacrifice Himself. And through the shedding of His blood, there is now an offer of forgiveness of sin. And as Jesus hung on that cross and eventually gave up the ghost and died and was buried in the grave for 3 days, and God through His glorious power raised Him from the dead, that you could have that salvation He offered you. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believe in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. That's what He's offering you today, if by faith you'll accept that. And whatever God's speaking to you about today, don't use excuses. Accept the challenge. As long as we have breath within us, we can carry out the commission and we can fight the battle against those things that keep us from wanting to do those things, and we can go in His strength to do the victories. Lord, we have tried to be faithful what You laid on our heart. And Lord, I know timing and everything is in Your hands. And God, You're sovereign over life and the things of life. And we're just believing and trusting that this message was divinely delayed until today. That this group of people, including this preacher, would hear and make a decision. A decision that will bring You honor and glory. A decision that will expand to heaven. A decision that can make life more bearable for those that are in this world. Thank you for what you're going to do as we march forward. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Let's stand as Bud and the ladies lead us in our invitation hymn.
Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to just as